today, I want to talk about one of the most beautiful pieces of music that has ever been written for solo piano. And to illustrate my talk, I've chosen a number of world-class pianists where we can show you the different interpretations that they choose to take, and obviously you can decide which one speaks to you the most. Or maybe you have your own favorite pianist and you could put that in the comments below. But as always, all the pieces of music I select, I will put links to in the comments below the video. But before we begin, perhaps a little context will be useful. Imagine, if you will, a young man, just 31 years of age, and he has a terminal illness, and he knows he has. He's been ill quite a lot through his life, probably linked to his poverty. Imagine too the archetypal image of a classical composer, poor and hungry and cold and struggling for his art. Well, that's exactly what we've got here. I'm talking about, of course, Franz Schubert. Now, Schubert lived his whole life sort of in the shadow from the great masters, Haydn, Mozart, and most of all, Ludwig von Beethoven. Beethoven died just 18 months before Schubert. And all through Beethoven's life, well, he knew about this young Schubert, but he didn't really acknowledge him. And sadly, it was only on Beethoven's deathbed, literally, that he was shown a more recent work of Schubert's, and he acknowledged, finally, what a genius he was. So here we are, the young Schubert, well, young because he's only 31 years of age, and he's facing death. And he has decided to write three piano sonatas to finalize and somehow encapsulate everything that was important to him. No longer is it important to try and win people's hearts and minds and fame and money. His teaching career is behind him. The poor man had to work part-time teaching all his life, although we believe he didn't like it. So this composition was just for him. It was his gift to us, if you will. And he wrote this suite of three piano sonatas. And today I want to talk about the last one, the great B flat number 21, and posthumously classified as D960. It wasn't even published until 10 years after his death. Can you imagine that? Now, it wasn't as if Schubert had no success in his life. He had these sort of musical soirees and a circle of friends who really admired him and recognized his genius. It's just that everybody wanted Beethoven. Other composers somehow or other seemed to get the limelight, the ticket. But let's just give you some numbers to give you an idea of what this person produced. In the 15 or 16 years that he was professionally composing, he wrote basically nearly 10 symphonies. Okay, only seven which were complete. But he also wrote seven operas and lots of work for the stage. He also wrote 20 string quartets and some string quintets and other orchestral and chamber works. He wrote 21 piano sonatas, of which the last one today we're going to talk about. And he wrote 20 settings for the Mass. And on top of that, the most incredible thing of all is that he wrote 600 songs. 600 songs, imagine that. If you put that in the pop world, that's 50 albums of content. all this in such a short span of time. This work you're going to hear now is one of the most profound pieces of music ever written. It's deep, it's dark, it takes you to the places where your inner soul is confronted with life itself. But it can also lift you and bring you to this vision of beauty and joy. So, let's begin. The first pianist that I've chosen is a pianist called Leif Ove Andsnes. And Andsnes, to me, is a modern, current, living pianist. In fact, I'm going to see him tomorrow night perform the Emperor Concerto in Brussels with the Belgian National Orchestra, and I'm really looking forward to it. But here he is on Warner Classics, and we're going to start with the first movement. And this beginning is so unusual. There's no bada to tell you, hey, it's starting. It's a gentle beginning. Molto moderato, moderately. Let's hear. This little rumble in the left hand, then the theme will repeat again. Listen to the left hand. Bom, 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 bom. Because it's this we're going to hear amongst the different pieces that we hear. It's clear, huh? Into the second theme. And the arpeggioic, left hand. Right, we'll leave that here. That's the introduction. This is the beginning of what is a very long first movement, nearly 20 minutes, in fact. Now I want to take you to a much earlier recording, one by a Russian pianist called Slavislav Richter. And Slavislav Richter was very famous for his Beethoven. But listen how he approaches the first movement. Now, obviously, the first thing we notice is that Richter is taking it way, way slower than Andsnes. It's almost too slow if you think about it. But if you listen to the whole piece and if you understand Richter, this is his way of really getting to the depths of human emotion. And Richter plays this in a very similar way that he would play Beethoven. If you ever listen to his Tempest recording, the Beethoven Tempest, on HMV, you'll see what I mean when he gets to the fiery parts. And later on, we will be listening to the next two movements, three movements, to compare and contrast how he tackles that. So that slow pace means that Richter needs another 5 minutes extra just for the first movement. Whoops, I've just pushed the wrong button. That's life. Now, the next person I want to compare the opening with, it's one of my favorite pianists, especially for Mozart. And I'm talking about Maria João Pérez. And let's hear how she opens this first movement. Very clear, bom, 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 left hand. Everything is in balance, isn't it? It's very beautiful. She still gets the emotion, but without the tragedy that Richter portrays. And this is the question. Is Schubert seeing his current position as a tragedy? Is he angry? Is he upset that his life is being cut so short, that he's never reached the fame that Beethoven had, that Mozart had, that Haydn had? Will he be worshipped in the streets with 20,000 people following his funeral cortege that von Beethoven had? Or is he just celebrating the beauty of life? Maria João Pérez brings it across beautifully. But there's one more person I'd like to talk about in this first movement. In fact, two. Is a pianist called Stephen Kovajevich. And Stephen Bishop Kovajevich, if I remember correctly. And I really like his rendition. And listen to the way his left hand takes on that repeated note. Can you hear? It's very, very quiet. It's here, it's prolific. But there are moments the tune is very prominent here. Now, the recording of this is in a bigger space where the room acoustics, just like with the Richter, is playing a bigger role. In fact, in many ways, you can say the sound of the piano in Richter's recording is not so brilliant. But here, the balance is much, much better. But there's one other pianist I think you should hear, because it will illustrate just how different you can take the same piece of music. Listen to the phrasing of Mitsuko Uchida. Listen to her phrasing. Now, there's a long gap before she starts playing at the beginning of this recording. I think it's even 10 seconds, and long gaps between each one, which is indicating how much she's building the passion. Thank you. now, as she lifts into this theme, listen to the phrasing, the spacing she builds. You're never quite sure exactly when she's going to move to the next progression. Her performance floats across. It's almost timeless in space. Now, obviously, all of these pianists are absolutely world class. And so, technically, they're all perfect. It's just simply a question of which one do you relate to? And the strange thing for me is that, depending what mood I'm in, I will switch. I'll choose one or the other. And well, I will come back to that later on. Let's move on to the second movement. And let's come back to our friend Leif Ove Andenæs for the second movement. Here, now what you would imagine in the second movement is that it would lift you up from this slow, gloomy, if you like, opening piece, but it doesn't. It even takes you further in, and this is probably why this piece of music, this I'm about to play you now, is often chosen for funerals, because it's like the best flamenco, the best fado from Portugal, the beauty and tragedy mixed together at the same time. And in this second movement, Andante Sostenuto, what does that mean? Andante means slow, and sostenuto is like playing the note for its full length. But here it means slower, a little slower. And I think that is obviously the message for us in this opening. Let's hear Leif Ove Andenæs open the second movement. Now, the tricky thing for pianists in this movement are those high notes, those right hand note, bom, bom. They can choose to play it extremely delicately, extremely softly, and run the risk of it not sounding fully. They can play it as you've just heard, clearly, precisely, but not too hard to dominate. Let's go back to Richter and see how he manages this. That's perfection in playing, right? But you see that Richter is creating a lot of space between each phrase, and you're not quite sure when it's going to begin or when he's holding back. And I think he gets that balance beautifully, but some might say it's a little old-fashioned. So let's hear Maria Joao Perez beginning this second movement. Listen closely and see how she goes ba-dum-bop. She's using the dampening pedal to emphasize you see, and that creates a beautiful precision space. But listen here. Now she opens the pedal up, so to get the full sound. This is the great thing about Maria Joao Perez. She changes it all the time from a sort of staccato effect to an open effect. Everything is constantly in evolution, transition. And that's what makes her such a great Mozart pianist as well. But you have to ask yourself, does this beautiful playing get to the heart, the soul of what you think this piece of music means? Let's listen to Mitsuko Uchida in the second movement now, because I think this is a very interesting interpretation, really very different from the others. Very similar style to Slavistak Richter, isn't it? With these mysterious pauses between each phrase. You may love it, or it might irritate you. how faint that note was. It was there. She didn't miss it. Whoa, absolutely beautiful. A very different kind of recording, though. It's almost, I can't say muddy, but it's a very warm recording. I think Adamson's recording is somewhere between the two, and of the recordings, technically, I kind of like that one the best. Maybe it's a bit more modern sounding from a pure technical point of view, but Deutsche Grammophon and Maria Joao Perez certainly handle it. But this is the second movement, and you just have to hear it for yourself to really appreciate it. Let's move on to the third movement. Let's get a little bit of a lift now. And no one better than Maria Joao Perez, because this is really where she sings, because it's called Allegro vivace con delicatezza. And it means delicately. Allegro, vivace, even fast, but delicately. And let's see how she manages this. Masterful. Let's just see and contrast with Leif Ove Andsnes, how he copes with it. What pace? Ooh. Quicker. He's using the vivace, yeah? But it's still delicate. You have to say that. He's getting a joy into it, isn't it? It's like the birds singing on a spring morning. Love it. But let's go back to Richter, because you can imagine after that very, very, very slow opening, he too might take it at such a pace to create some contrast. Let's find out. Indeed. Now, obviously, compared to Adner's, the piano sounds much further back. There's much more room effect. But you get used to that after a while. Once you've got through the first two movements, that shouldn't annoy you anymore. You'll just be so engaged in his precision. But he's ba-ba-ba. You see, it's more, it's not quite as delicate as Leif Ove Andsnes, is it? So that leaves us one more person, of course, in our group, or even two. And that's obviously Mitsuko Uchida. So let's just see how she takes the scherzo, the Allegro vivace con delicatezza. Thank you. And Stephen Kovajevich, let's see how he takes it. Nice pace, nice and delicate. Nice recording too. There's the room effect in the recording, which you hear very much in the precise. Enjoying this comparison. Isn't it interesting to see how these world-class pianists at the top of their game are handling this? And now we move on to the last movement. And let's start this time with our good friend Slavistoch Richter. Slavistav Richter, I must say. And here we go on the last movement. Delicate, but there's a hint of what's to come. About 2.5 minutes into this movement, it becomes a double forte, and then you will hear Richter perform very much in that Beethoven style which I mentioned within The Tempest. It becomes very similar. You can feel it building. It's not there yet. He's still taking it in a very delicate way. So that's Richter. We'll come back to him in a minute. Let's see how Maria João Pérez takes it, because we can imagine that she's going to be very precise. But how fast will she go? What is Allegro Vivace for her? For me, that sounds exactly bang on. And Mitsuko Ishida, let's see how she takes it. Phrasing and pace there, that's typical Ishida. And you either love it or you hate it. Well, not hate it, is what we say in England, Marmite. You either love it or hate it. I think we should hear Kovajevich. Let's see. Piano isn't better, to be honest. guess he chose it. Maybe this is the sound that he likes. This leaves us, leave over others. Let's see how he gets on with that last movement. Now, what we need to do is see what happens when we're getting to that fortissimo. Let's see how Adnes plays it. You're in for such a treat with this sonata. It's long, but it's so beautiful. Now, I'd like to play you the last movement a bit further in, where it's becoming fortissimo, to see really how Richter handles it. We can expect it to be very Beethoven, very aggressive and intense. Let's just see, shall we? That's typical Richter. And if you can live with the older style recording, if that's your thing, then why not? Because it's such a great interpretation. So let's finish with Maria João Pérez in that same section. She slowed down in this section because I'm not sure why, but she obviously wants to get that. It's probably because it's marked Allegro ma non troppo. And so she's keeping that slower pace. Let's just remember how fast she takes the opening. You see? It's not crazy, is it? And so, when you hear her later on, I get the feeling she's slowed down to create some space for herself. Not technically, but from an emotional interpretation point. Because music is about contrasts, about light and shade, and all the textures and colours in between. And the pianist has to bring all that out just simply by allowing a felt hammer strike a string. But if I could only have one recording of all of these, I think I would take the Leaf over Unsness, because it's so rounded, the balance between all of them. You've got the idea of what Schubert was trying to convey. And yes, I would love to have the Richter version as well, purely for contrast. But yeah, also the Adnes version is very well recorded on the Werner Classics. But let's just play out with Leave Over Unsness, ending the sonata. In a way, almost where we began, but reflecting on the beauty and the delicacy of the third movement with our Allegro ma non troppo presto ending. Thank you. you have been, thank you for listening, and I'll see you in the next video.